Father, we thank you. We thank you because you're a faithful God. Father, we thank you because you are merciful. Father, we thank you because you are ever present in times of need. Lord Almighty, we give you glory today. Father, we will forever rejoice in your presence. Lord Almighty, we will forever dwell in your presence and walk in your ways all the days of our lives. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Please just give a clap of praise to the Lord, even as the apostles take their seats. Amen. Praise the Lord. This is 2016, and here we have, the Lord has declared this year as the year of his presence. Amen. Last week we heard about that where the Lord is present, he will be nearby, he will be helpful, he will not forsake you, he will be in a proximate distance, he can be reached. Amen. And that is the promise of God even in this year, that he will always be nearby. You will always be where you can reach him. And today we're just going to look at another dimension, that where in God's presence, sometimes we're needed, it's needed for us to go forward. It's there for us to go forward so we can enter into our destinies. Because sometimes when you are looking around, you're paralyzed by fear about the future, about what will happen. You know, on the 22nd, we have the economic outlook. And sometimes I say to myself that ignorance is bliss. That maybe one shouldn't be as knowledgeable about financials, markets, and all that as one is, because if you're not, you can truly walk in faith, believing God that all things are possible. Because sometimes you find, I was talking to a doctor, and I said that it is very difficult for doctors to actually believe in divine healing, because a lot of the time they have too much knowledge. But for laymen like us, because you don't know the reason, you don't know the cause, you don't know where it's ending, if something happens, it's you just lay your hands on it, on yourself, and just decree God's healing. And a lot of the time, you will be healed in Jesus' name. But the doctor would have analyzed all the causes of the event, of why you have that swelling. And for him, he's looking at, okay, this is caused by this, so it must go this way. But the ways of the Lord are not always known to man. Praise the Lord. So today, we'll be looking at a group of people who were faced with the kind of despair that we face today. You know, everywhere you turn, oil price is at its lowest point since 2004 or something like that. The IMF is predicting that it will go down to 20. Nigeria budget is designed to be balanced at 80 or something like that, or 100. So there's a huge gap between where we are and where we should be. And it's really worrying. But you know, in the midst of all that, the Lord is able and the Lord is present. Amen? So we have to look at not onto the economy, not onto what the experts say, but we have to look onto what the Lord says. And today the Lord is saying, go forward. Praise the Lord. So let's turn our Bibles to Exodus chapter 14, verses 10 to 16. I'm reading from the New King James Version, and I suggest that we all read. We can read it all together. When Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were afraid. And the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. And then they said to Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you so dealt with us to bring us out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians then we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. Verse 14, it says, the Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. Lastly, verse 15, and the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. Amen? Tell the children of the city of David to go forward. Tell the children of Nigeria to go forward. Amen? Praise the Lord. You know, fear can sometimes, fear is real. So there's no need trivializing it. And fear has no rules. Sometimes fear is justified because of what you actually are facing. It's real. The circumstances are fearful. Sometimes fear is irrational and unrelated to the circumstances. It's just a figment of your imagination. But either way, fear is fear. And when you are afraid, it needs to be dealt with somehow or the other for you to move into the promised land. And that was the same situation the children of Israel faced coming up to the Red Sea. There, they had listened to this smooth-talking Moses who promised them a land filled with milk and honey. And I said, oh, come, let's go. The Lord has asked us to go, and that the Lord will take us to this promised land. And they believed him. They believed him because they saw mighty miracles. They saw the firstborn of Egypt die. They saw the plagues. They saw the frogs come out of the Red Sea. They saw all kinds of deliverances, and they saw God create a Goshen for them in Egypt. So they believed him, and they were right to believe the Lord. They were right to believe Moses. But a few days after, here they are. At this first challenge that they face, the old fear comes back. You find, they start turning around to Moses and start blaming him. Why did you bring us out here? Wouldn't it have been better for us to be in Egypt? You know, in Egypt, we had food to eat. We did this. Then all of a sudden, people who were yearning to get out of Egypt were suddenly blaming the man for taking them out of a place that they all sincerely hated. And that is the way of the human mind. It is very easy. The easiest thing to do is to pass the blame to somebody else. And I guess it's part of that escapism that we face, that once something happens, we look for somebody to blame, and it has to be somebody else's responsibility. Unfortunately, in Africa, for instance, we are never wrong. It is the people in the village. It is that old woman who does not want your progress. Meanwhile, early in the morning, you refuse to get up to go and walk, or you refuse to study hard. But it is the woman in the village that is stopping you from getting up from your bed because they don't want your progress. It is easy to blame people outside when truly they may not be the fault, when truly the enemy may be within. And so are the children of Israel. Jewish folklore tells us that there were four groups of people at that point in time, and they had four different opinions, all justified. So what did Moses say? Moses did not dismiss their fears, because the fear, like I say, fear is real. And fear need not be rational. For instance, everybody here knows that it is the way of all living things to die. The Bible says so. So all of us are going to die one day. But everybody, okay, let me not say everybody. Most people, including me, but some are spiritual giants here. But most of us are afraid of death. But we know that it will die someday. So it's something that is inevitable, yet we are afraid of it. So there's a bit of disconnect there. For the women, by the grace of God, if you live long enough, menopause will come. And yet, a lot of women, if you tell them menopause is coming, they start to panic. when it is something that they should be glad in, that it is the Lord that has made them to live long enough to see menopause. Amen? And the men, at some point or the other, erectile dysfunction will come, whether you like it or not, because it is unlikely that at age whatever, that all the organs of your body will be functioning. That is natural. But you tell a man, and you say, it's not my portion. But at some point, whether it comes at 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100, it will come someday. And yet, we are afraid of it. So fear, but the thing to do is not to trivialize fear. Because fear is real. The fears that we have are real. And my fears may not be your fears. So the fact that I'm not afraid of this particular thing does not make me more qualified to criticize your own fear. Because whatever situation you are afraid of, those are your realities. And those are the things that you're afraid of. So I've looked at something that, there are four faces of fear that psychologists typically, and reactions that people have to fear. And all those four reactions are faced by the people of Israel. And Moses actually addresses them in the scriptures we've read today. The first one is self-sabotage. You find a group of people who will tell you, because the Egyptians were coming, instead of these Egyptians to kill us, it is better for us to die by our own hands. Let us just kill ourselves so that they won't take us prisoners. All these years we've been suffering, why should we allow ourselves to be captured again by Pharaoh? You know, suicide is... suicidal thoughts are thoughts that lots of people have faced from time to time. They are not necessarily... and sometimes they are justified, sometimes they are not justified, but it's never the option out. And sometimes it's just the enemy playing games with your mind because the Lord is taking you through somewhere. I remember many years ago, I had finished school sets in 1977 and I'd passed it. In those days, you took individual entrance exams. Yes, I can see some of you looking, but yes, it was in 1977. And and I'd passed into the universities to study medicine. So I'd post to everybody in the neighborhood, I was not a campus boy. And then that year, school set results were delayed. And when the results came out, in my school, they had canceled chemistry. I remember going from Enugu to Amusoka to Enugu to go and check the results at the work office. And when I saw, and they had canceled the number of subjects, so my result was incomplete. And as I was going back to Amusoka, everything in my mind was, how are you going to face the world? All these people that you've told, I'm going to the university, how are you going to tell them that you now have to go back to secondary school to retake school set? And as I was going back, I was sitting in the back of a 504 station wagon, and I was staying by the seat by the door. And the driver, typical of Nigerian commercial drivers, was doing about 130 or 140. And the thoughts that were going through my mind was, just open the door and you will roll out and this will be the end. Isn't this better for you to go and do this than for you to face all these people that you've posed for, that you've already left secondary school and now you have to go back to secondary school and start wearing uniforms again? And the thoughts were real. And it just took the mercy of God for me not to open the door and obey that voice. Many years after, I know that I would have made a horrible doctor. Because even till today, I almost start to faint when you're telling me stories about some ailments. I'm not saying see the thing. I'm just saying just tell me the story and then my stomach starts to churn. So I don't know. I know that I would have made a horrible doctor. And here was God saying, and why was I going to study medicine? My father had wanted to study medicine and had maneuvered me somehow to go and study medicine in his place because his parents couldn't afford to send him to school. So in my mind, it was just something I was doing to satisfy my parents. But God knew that he who knows the beginning from the end, He knew that this man was not made to be a doctor. So if it took canceling chemistry results in my center for me not to do medicine, and the number of other things that happened after, the Lord put those obstacles on my path so that I would not study medicine. And today I am grateful to the Lord Almighty for taking me through a path to something that I enjoy doing. Hallelujah. So sometimes people choose self-sabotage because they are afraid and because of the fear that others may force them to fail. Sometimes because they are afraid of failure, so they would choose self-sabotage. Sometimes it's the fear of rejection, so they foreclose their minds to something. A few nights ago, my wife was talking to a young man who had seen a young girl that he liked. And my wife says, oh, she has a boyfriend. And the boy was already foreclosed. So I heard it and I said to him, until there's a ring, there's nothing permanent. If the man is floating around and has done nothing, go ahead, let the better man win. Because the boy in question had been floating around this girl for months and for years and had not said anything meaningful. And here was this boy with the best of intentions and willing to say something very quickly. And the boy was already becoming afraid of the rejection that may come. I said to him, forget that this boy is floating around. Forget whatever it is. Go to her. She can only say what? No. And if she says no, you go back again. At some point, because the other man has not said something, maybe she will see something that will make her say yes. So for our young men who are afraid of rejection, and that is why today you are not yet married, because a lot of young men, what is holding them up is that they're afraid that if they go, this fine babe will now say no, and she will tell all her friends. Big deal. The one that's, if five say no, eventually one will say yes. And you never know. The one that you think will say no will be the one that will say yes. Because I find that, going back to the days of Egypt, the finest babes were often the most lonely because people were afraid of going to them. So don't think that because she's this, she's that, that she will not agree. So the fear of rejection should not stop you from proceeding to enter into your destiny. And if you look at how did Moses address this, Moses said to them, do not be afraid. It wasn't just a command. It was profound advice. Because quite a lot of the time, fear is driving you towards self-sabotage. And once you admit that it is fear that is driving you, more than half your problems are over. You know, there are people, some of us who pray 4 hours at night, not because we love the Lord so much, but because we are afraid. Praise the Lord. Whatever it is anyway, just pray. So, if you admit that it is fear that is driving you, half your problems are over. Because once you face the act, once you face it, it is easier to solve the problem. And once you admit that this is a problem, you know, one set of people that I like are our brethren from Warri. They say, if door no close, you no go no say window open. So if until you realize that it is fear that is causing it, so that this is what is shutting the door, you can't see the opportunities from that situation. So it's nice for you to actually take a break and say, yes, this is the problem. What do I do? And that's what Moses said to them, this set of people who were saying, this is bad. Because when you look at it, their fears were real. The Egyptian army at the point in time was like the American army of today, with multiple weapons, some that they will stay here and press a button and it will travel 500 kilometers and detonate on top of the man's house. That was the army that they were facing. So if you think about it, just hearing those horses and chariots, and you know, the armies of the ancient world had a way to strike fear. Somehow the horsemen knew how to ride in unison. So you hear the clop of the horses all at the same time, like bakaram, bakaram, bakaram. And I mean, it was so if you heard it, All that was needed was for you to look for somewhere to dig the ground and fall under and enter. And that was what they saw. So today, if you are facing, I don't know what the situation is you're facing. I'm speaking to myself as well. Whatever it is you're facing, whether you're facing debts, whether you're facing barrenness, whether you're facing illness, whatever it is, the Lord is saying to you, do not be afraid. Amen? Saying, do not be afraid. Praise the Lord. Because it is only when you overcome those fears, that you can enter into your destiny. Amen? The next set of people would have been the people who were saying, let us turn back and fight. These were the people that today, you know, a lot of the time, fighting is an irrational response to fear. Some of the people who you find who fight in public, a lot of the time when they are fighting, it's not because they believe they are strong. They're actually afraid, and it's their own reaction to fear is that they fight, they lash out. So sometimes when people lash out, they're not lashing out because they are strong. They're lashing out of weakness, and it's their own way of covering up those weaknesses. So there were people in this, in the camp, who were arguing, let us die like giants. Let us die, even if it causes whatever it is, let us die fighting. Why should we go back and be enslaved? Why should we do this? Because for them, the option to fight was the response of men. Yeah, so fighting, when directed, when the things are good, is nice. But if I remember Chinua Achebe saying that many a times, cowards stand in front of the desolate house of a brave man and say, there once lived a brave man there. Because in the course of fighting, needful fights and needless fights, the man died. And the same cowards who could not hold a candle to him lived longer than him and could now point to his house and say, when Okonkwo was here, this could not have happened. But Okonkwo has gone. Amen? So it's fighting is good, but the Bible tells us that no man starts building a house without counting the cost. No general goes to war without evaluating your resources. So sometimes when your resources are inadequate, fighting may not be the best course of action. I see a number of ex-military men here, and I'm sure that Admiral, am I? Because really, sometimes he who fights and runs away lives to fight on another day. So, because fighting does require skills, requires energy, requires resources. So if you don't have the resources to fight and complete the fight successfully, it may be better for you to regroup. If you look at the American strategy in Iraq, they pulled out of Iraq because they know two reasons. They can never win. Why? The people in Iraq, ISIS for instance, a major part of their reason is to actually provoke the war of the apocalypse in. So they are willing to die for that war to happen. They are willing to do whatever it is to cause that, so for the armies of the West and the East to come. That is actually the purpose of ISIS. So they know the Bible, but they have then twisted the principles of the Bible, and they are trying to use devilish things for those things to occur. So the Americans understand that principle, and they know that if we stay in Iraq, we will just provoke an unnecessary end. So they decided to pull out of Iraq, spoke all the grammar, and they will never win. So they've gone out, we'll help you fight the war, we'll bomb you from afar, we'll train your people to fight, we'll do this. So you can never claim that we are the people you are defeating. So from time to time, you may need to reevaluate your strategy. And that is what Moses said to them. Amen? Says, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. So Moses was saying to them, there's no need for you to fight. Just stand still and you will see what the Lord will do. Because if they had gone to fight, God had sent them go into the promised land. Going back to fight would have meant taking them away from the promised land. And that was not the purpose of God. God had proposed, just keep moving forward, you'll get to the promised land. And then fighting would have meant you have to turn back and then start fighting, which would have been a distraction or a diversion from where God had sent them to. Praise the Lord. The third group were those who were saying, let us retreat. Let us go back and beg Pharaoh, lest he kills us. And between you and I, sometimes this is a reasonable, we consider this a reasonable option. And given the circumstances, these people were very justified. Pharaoh needed slaves to continue to build the pyramids and all that. So if they went back, Pharaoh would not kill all of them. Pharaoh may kill a few of the ringleaders, like Moses. So they were going to sacrifice Moses. But the bulk of the people would have provided slave labor, so Pharaoh would not. It wasn't in Pharaoh's interest. Because why was Pharaoh coming back? He suddenly realized that the economy was going to collapse without free labor that the Israelites had provided all the years. So Pharaoh would never have killed them. He would have taken them back and enslaved them for longer. So it was a rational thing, if you think about it from man's perspective, because what would have happened would have been that they would just have gone back and it would have been life as usual. But why? God is more powerful than the Egyptians. So God is more powerful than whatever the circumstances you are facing today. No matter what it is, whether you're looking for dollar to pay bills, whether you're looking for dollar to pay rent, or whether you're looking for money to pay rent or school fees, whatever it is, or money to eat, or a job to do, whatever it is, God is bigger than those circumstances. Amen? God is bigger than whatever the situation you face in your life. Whether you've looked for a baby for 10 years or more, God is bigger. If I hadn't been called upon to speak today, I was going to go to Port Harcourt, one of our pastors who has not had a baby in 13 years, had a baby and is having a big Thanksgiving where he's harassed everybody who he knows and who is his friend to please come. Because he never gave up. 13 years after, they have a set of twins. Amen? And once you realize this, it is easier for you to move forward and be confident that the future is bright. Amen? But I'll add a caveat in a very low voice. Faith cannot be blind. Amen? Faith cannot be blind. Moses was asking the Egyptians, the Israelites, to move forward. But until something happened, they could not move forward into the Red Sea. I.e., they could only put their foot on the first thing. And they trusted God. They knew that God would come through for them. Sometimes we need to look at the situation and decide prayerfully what is the right faith to exercise. Because, for instance, the choir people know that my voice is very good. So, if somebody says to me, exercise your faith to be a choir leader, it may be foolhardy of me to decide to replace Tony Adoki. Because if singing in a melodious voice was the only qualification for heaven, some of us will never make it. So it's important for you to recognize what your skills are, what gifts the Lord has given to you, what talents the Lord has given to you, and apply them with wisdom rather than exercise blind faith. I'm not saying that miracles now don't happen. Miracles do happen. With the Lord, nothing is impossible. But just recognize that if the Lord chooses not to do the impossible, just recognize that He is the Lord. Amen? Praise the Lord. The last group of people were those who entered into a state of learned helplessness. You know, you can't really blame this set of people. They had spent 400 years in slavery, doing what they were told. So making decisions was not their strong point. Their self-esteem was at its lowest point that it could be. Here were people stand. Even when the trials were coming, they used to give them straw for bricks. Then they said, no more straw, but you must make double the bricks that you made before. And yet they made the thing. So these were people used to acting like Fela would say, zombies. Move, they move. Do this, they do. So they were not people who were, as business people would say, used to acting, business managers would say, used to acting with initiative. They were people who were used to following orders. So they were in a state of paralysis. They had decided there was nothing we could do. And their response would have been, let us just kneel down, close our eyes, and just pray to God to help. It is always useful to pray. But a lot of the time, praying without doing something may not always be the right option. Praying without the intention of doing something may not be the right response. Sometimes, in exceptional circumstances, there are situations where you don't do anything, it just drops on your lap. But a lot of the time, because the Lord blesses with a process, because a lot of the time, the blessings that you will get, God prepares you for those blessings. You find that there's a process to you getting there. And part of that process is for you to do something. Part of that process is for you to be trained. Part of that process is for you to be diligent. Part of that process is for you to be doing something. He says that except the Lord watches with the watchman watches in vain. So part of the process is for you as a watchman to be watching. He says except the Lord builds with the builder builds in vain. So part of that process is for you to be building so that the Lord will build with you. So if you decide that after it is the Lord that builds, so you won't apply for CFO. You will not apply for building plan approval. You will not get an architect to do the drawing for you. And you fold your hands and say, it is the Lord that builds. Well, perchance, you may find somebody who will decide, come here, I want to build a house for you. Yes, but a lot of the time, that does not always happen. Amen? So, Moses, what was Moses' response? Moses, in this example, said to them, what do you want to do? The Lord will fight for you, yes. But what did Moses ask them to do? Verse 15. Exodus 14, 15. Let's look at it and see. Tell the people of Israel to what? To what? Go forward. Because a lot of the time, shutting yourself in does not provide a solution. If you're going through embarrassing financial circumstances and you decide, let me not go out so that they don't see me, how will the people who will help you see you? How will people who need your services come to you? You may have the most innovative invention, but if people around the world don't see that invention, you can never sell it and you can never make money from it. So you must recognize that your progress to promised land needs you to what? Go forward. Needs you to do something. Needs you to position yourself somewhere. Even if you look at the widow who had nothing was told, go and bring, what do you have? Jars of oil, empty jars, go and bring them, because it needed jars of oil for her to progress. What do you say? You always need to do something. Even the widow of Zarephath had to go and bake the last with that, had to do something. So if you look at all the people who the Lord had blessed, in a lot of the cases, they had to do something. Jesus Christ said, lift up your and follow me. So, you know, all kinds of, they had to do something. They had to move forward. They had to stand up. And the lame stood up. If the lame did not stand up, he would not have walked. Amen? If the lame man had not stood up, he would not have walked. So today the Lord is asking you, whatever the situation you are facing, stand up. move forward. It is then that the Lord will bless your going forward. The Lord will be with you. So in the process of facing paralysis, we should remember that the Lord will ask you to go forward. The Lord will always make a way for you. Where there seems to be no way, because this was what exactly happened with these people. There seemed to be no way. Behind them, there was Pharaoh with all the armies of Egypt. In front of them, there was the Red Sea. And miles on end without any solution. So there seemed to be no way. You couldn't go to the left. You couldn't go to the right. So what was it? The Lord will always make a way where there seems to be no way. So even at this point, let's take that song. That the Lord will make a way where there seems to be no way.
Lord, make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my God. Hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way. He will make a way. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my God. Hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way. He will make a way.
Let's rise to our feet and just pray to the Lord Almighty who will make a way. And just use Exodus 14, 13 to 14 to 16 to 15 as our prayer point today as we move forward into the future. That we will not be afraid. That we will stand still and see the salvation of the Lord which he will accomplish for us today. Even in this new year, that the Egyptians, that the challenges that we see today will not see again forevermore. That the Lord will fight for us and we shall hold our peace. And that the Lord says, why do you cry? Because he wants us to go forward. He tells the children of the city of David to go forward. So let's just pray now and just ask the Lord Almighty. Ask the Lord Almighty to go with us. To come into the situations that we face. To make a way where there seems to be no way. To fight for us. To take away our fears, take away our worst enemies, which invariably is our fears of what will happen, sometimes real, sometimes imagined. Ask the Lord Almighty to enable us to conquer fear, to conquer helplessness, to conquer irrational paralysis, to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, to trust the Lord in all that he will do. Because the Lord is able to make a way where there seems to be no way. And to give us the enablement to trust in the Lord, to know what to do, and to go forward in whatever the situation is. Because the Lord has said that this year that we shall go forward from victory into victory. We shall go forward into our promised land. We shall go forward into our destiny. Just as the Lord Almighty, that his destiny for you shall be fulfilled. That the Lord Almighty, the plans that the Lord Almighty have for you this year shall be fulfilled. That you shall go forward from victory unto victory. That you will go forward unto greater things. That greater things that you have not seen, you will see this year. Now, no matter what the circumstances are, you choose not to look on the circumstances of life. But you choose to look on our Lord who is able to do all things. Just ask the Lord Almighty to be with you. Father, we thank you. Lord Almighty, we thank you for your children have called upon you. Lord Almighty, we'll give you glory. Father, we'll come and testify as to your goodness. We'll come and testify that you've been faithful to us in all things. Lord Almighty, will come and give you glory. Father, this year we choose to walk with you. We choose to go forward in accordance with your word. Lord Almighty will give you glory today. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Even at this point, there are a few of us who may not have found the salvation of the Lord. We do not yet know the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. Yes, we've prayed. But unless you have found the Lord as your Savior, your prayers may be wasted. So even at this point in time, I want to ask, if you're here today and you do not yet know the Lord as your Savior, if you're here today and the clarion call comes and you're not sure of salvation, just to raise your hand, I want to pray with you that the blessings of God will be complete. So if you're here and you've not yet found the Lord as your Savior, just remain standing and we'll pray with you. If you're here and you have not yet found the Lord, just remain standing and we'll pray with you, because this is the year of promise. This is the year that the Lord has chosen to make all things good for you. Just remain standing and we just want to pray with you. If you're here and you do not yet know the Lord as your Savior, if you're here and you are not sure of the salvation of God, if there are broken hedges in your life, just stand to your feet, because the Lord I know that there are few people who are afraid of what people will say. So just come forward, just stand and come forward if you receive the card. Even if you haven't received the card, just come forward. Let's clap for them. Let's encourage them to come forward. Whether you've received the card or not, just come forward. If you feel that there are rough edges that the Lord, you want the Lord to make straight, just come forward here. Just come forward now.
There's a